And now, reality. I had a reality check yesterday. I was in a car accident, and it just, like, my life just flashed before my eyes. I thought I was dying. I wasn't. So there's so many ways and so many different things that causes us to kind of get a reality check. And I think as creatives, there's so many different moments in our lives where either we choose not to see it, we're kind of in denial because we're in kind of a tough spot, and but somehow, either through support or through our self-motivation, we kind of cause ourselves to get that reality check and move forward, and that's kind of the only way we progress in life. And so in thinking about this theme and thinking about the challenges, the uphill battles, and then also the good stuff that comes with being a creative, I thought of Sharayna as kind of the perfect person to speak on that. She has done a number of things in her life, being a dancer in Harlem. She was a professional ballet dancer. She moved here. She was in the corporate world for a little bit, and then went back into the arts and created Muse 360, which is an amazing program. I'll actually read it right here. It's a nonprofit organization that serves over 400 youth annually in Baltimore, offering high-quality arts programming. They offer three programs in preparatory dance, arts entrepreneurship, and international artistic study. In fact, they are going to be taking a number of amazing youth to Cuba. They just had a fundraising event at Mai Tai, and you can still donate money so they can go to Cuba in style and not have to worry about anything. So that's amazing. It's amazing that, you know, there are organizations here in the city that are led by individuals like Sharayna that are just doing the work, and the work speaks for itself. She's very professional and passionate about what she does. I'm gonna make her blush, but she is, and it definitely speaks from the struggle and just the challenges that she faces each day. So without further ado, oh, one more thing. If you are going to ask questions, tweet us at Baltimore_CM. That's Baltimore_CM. Aisha, get a Twitter. but we're gonna try to just keep it via social media, save lives, and keep it via social media. So again, that's Baltimore_CM, and I'll be back up here later, but for now, welcome Sharayna Christmas.
So first I just wanna say welcome to my home. Muse 360 is housed here, and I'm really excited that Creative Mornings chose to come here and chose me. I'm very honored. And thank you for getting up early and being on time. I mean, I'm kind of proud of myself too, because I have a six-year-old and we never get to school on time. So today we got to school on time, another reality check. I thought this topic was quite interesting because I think throughout my career and my life, and I don't consider myself extremely old, but I've experienced a lot of things and a lot of, you know, cold water in my face that has brought reality to the forefront. And I wanted to start with a quote. And though she said, I'm professional and I'm polished and all those different things, sometimes reality just does not allow for that. So I'm gonna read the quote. How we all want so badly to divorce reality, but that bitch just won't sign the papers. So I think for me, I just wanted to talk briefly about this. You know, again, I'm not from Baltimore, but growing up, it was a lot of things that I fantasized about. You think about the perfect life, you think about getting married, having children, having the job that pays a lot, retirement, becoming spiritually balanced. All those things are a fantasy. And being in Baltimore really raised me. You know, I spent most of my adult life here just experiencing things, really on a quest to really find myself. And I think about myself when I was in my 20s, and now I'm not in my 20s, and very far from my 20s. But you know, when I think about this, I actually experienced this in real life. Definitely going through a situation where I had to break relationships and realizing that people around me are not necessarily going to be with me for the rest of my life. And so when life happens, it throws you a curveball and you have to really pretty much make do. And one of the biggest things that happened in my life, so here I am, you know, 22 years old, I met Troy Burton, who is the executive director here, and I'm like, oh, you know, I teach dance over at the Druid Hill YMCA, I just graduated from Morgan, I mean, I work in finance, but I want to teach ballet. And I wanted to start my organization here. And at 22, starting an organization is like having a child. But then, about 7 years later, when I actually did have a child, that's when reality really hit, so.
As a child, I asked my mother, is there a morning star? I was answered by my mother, yes, there's a morning star. Just before the dawn, she whispered, a light will appear above, and this light that greets the sunrise, this is the star of love. For this is the morning star that shines above. Yes, this is the morning star. This is the star of love. And then I ask my mother, will I see the morning star? I was answered by my mother, you will see the morning star. It gleams for just one moment in the skies. Then it shines forever after, deep in a mother's eyes. That's when I learned how wise all mothers are. For there in my mother's eyes, I saw the morning star, the love light in her eyes, shining bright like the morning star.
So yeah, so that was a life-changing event for me. Quitting my job in 2007 to run Muse 360 and not even knowing how to run a nonprofit. I mean, I didn't grow up around entrepreneurs. I didn't grow up, I mean, not per se. I didn't grow up, you know, necessarily knowing how to do these things. And then life throws me a curveball. And I had a child. And I actually had my child at home. I decided to have a home birth just to make matters even more real. but it was really a wonderful life-changing event. And in the midst of these things, when you're trying to run a business, when you're trying to serve young people, so here I am, I had served young people for probably about, 7 years at this point. And reality hits you, and you say to yourself, you know, I just can't do it all. You know, I have to be a mother. And what you saw in that video, my son was about 19 months old. My son actually was put in a coma when he was 19 months old because he had a serious lung infection. He had RSV and pneumonia. And so you can imagine, and this was December 21st. We were in the hospital until December 30th, the day before New Year's. And you can say, you know, I'm just, you know, I have business going. I have, you know, my organization is getting ready to close programming for the year. But here it is, my son that is getting sick and has a situation. And a lot of times when I talk to people about life. Because I can talk to you about all the accomplishments that I've had. I can talk to you about how I was able to battle Wall Street and how I was able to do ballet from the age of 3 all the way up through high school. Or how I was able to help my mother pay her bills. But having a child and having to still keep a solid head, particularly here in Baltimore City, was the ultimate reality check. Watching your child be sick, and he still kind of deals with the situation, but he is, and some of you guys know Lil Bashi, he's very rambunctious and he's wonderful. But to really overcome these things really taught me to be resilient. And honestly, when you have these life experiences, when I look to work with folks, I don't just look at your resume. I don't look at just what your background is. I look at what are your values? What are the things that connect you to people? What are the things that connect you to life? And this is one of the life-changing events that connected me. And you can imagine, anybody is familiar with nonprofit, anybody runs their own nonprofit program, raise your hand. So you know how it is when you gotta write grants, you know how it is you gotta show up. It's not just a 9-to-5 where you're sitting at home. So imagine, you know, having to deal with that. But becoming a mother, per se, is one of the most life-changing events that I've experienced. I don't know if you guys heard this quote, expectation is the root of all heartache. Lord have mercy. You know, I always say that I've been able to balance my career. I think I'm pretty good at that. But when it comes to matters of the heart, I am very sensitive. If you didn't know, if you know me, I'm sensitive. And I think that I've been raised to be very loyal. I've been raised to show up for people, to call people on their birthdays, to acknowledge people when I see them, to remember their names, to remember their faces. And so I've experienced a lot of heartache just in my personal life, as well as trying to run my organization, particularly here in Baltimore. And the reality is, being a Black woman trying to do the things that I've done, people, when they met me, they might have met me 8 years after I've already taken kids to 6 different countries, and they're like, I have never heard of you. And I'm like, girl, I just met you 2 weeks ago. And so what ends up happening is, and what people don't realize, is that the burden that you endure as a person of color, a woman, having to keep pushing through a lot of these things does bring a lot of heartache. And so I've really learned that happiness is the balance between expectation and reality. Like, I'll be happy when I really don't have to expect that you're gonna call me back when I call you. Because I say, you know what, he might be busy, right? And so that is one of the things that I've really been able to manage. Now again, when it comes to matters of the heart and relationships and things like that, I think that we've been kind of domesticated in a sense to expect people to do things for us when they really don't owe us much. But one of the greatest lessons that I've learned is to take care of myself and the expectation that I have to treat myself with love. And that's why, again, the life-changing event of me having a son, watching some of my young people grow, you know, growing up the way that I did, the love that comes back to that helps me manage my expectations and ultimately makes me a happier person. And so I choose happiness. Now, when I was in my 20s, I was just expecting the world to be like, why don't you do, you know, all these different crazy things. But what does that do? That causes stress, that causes a lot of anger. And unfortunately, the harsh realities that we live in, we need to choose a little bit of happiness, a little bit of sunshine. So this is one of my favorite quotes. I know it's kind of tough, but it's true for me. For me also, you know, with just, again, back to expectations for a second and just really dealing with reality, making a conscious choice through all of the mud and all of the crap and you know, stuff that I have to go through every day. Looking at my son in the morning, looking at, you know, appreciating the fact, this is the balance that you find, that I found, find in reality. You know, looking at the fact that it's sunny today and it's not raining. Those are the small things. And one of my favorite authors is Zora Neale Hurston. She has a book that says, you know, I love me when I'm smiling, and I love me when I'm not having a good day. So at the end of the day, you know, I interact with people, and I've interacted with people in this room, in business and nonprofit world and the arts, and being creative does not mean that you're always happy. Being creative does not mean that you can't have a difficult conversation. I can have a lot of difficult conversations and still love you to death. And that is reality. To think that I can only have, you know, easy breezy happiness, especially living in Baltimore City, y'all know what it is. That's just not reality and that's not realistic. So Zora Neale Hurston, in all her wonderfulness, and if you guys are not familiar with Zora Neale Hurston, she was a writer during the Harlem Renaissance era. She's from South Florida, okay? She was very fearless, and I really love her. So she says, I have the nerve to walk my own way, however hard in my search for reality rather than climb upon the rattling wagon of wishful illusions. So when I think about this, and I think about the wishful illusion part, particularly, you know, working with people in the nonprofit world, working with people as, you know, a woman of color, and, you know, sometimes I might have like a little smirk on my face because I'm thinking after you've lived life, particularly for 11 to 12 years I've been doing what I'm doing, and after you've lived that life and you're interacting with people and people are talking about all the little things that they want you to do, and, you know, we want you to dance and we want your kids to come and sing a praise song and we want you to do this, that, and oh, we want you to do all of this for free, that's a wishful illusion, okay? The work that I do, again, you know, is my life. And I've decided to live out my passion. That doesn't mean that, you know, when people meet me, they're like, oh, you're so lucky, you know, you're actually living your passion. But in reality, right, it's not as easy. And so I choose not to live through wishful illusions. If you ever come into my organization and you meet me and you see me interact with my students, I'm very honest. I'm very real. I'm very transparent. I actually teach my children, my youth, about giving feedback and accepting feedback. And accepting that everyone is just not going to be your friend. Everyone is not going to be as genuine with you as you are with them. But one of the things that I try to do in thinking about this quote is I really try to walk my own way. I'm not trying to walk like you. I'm not trying to walk like you. I'm not trying to dress like you. And I've been like that since I was a kid. Now, what has that brought me? I'm kind of a loner. Okay, here you have it, a young lady, young girl growing up in Harlem. Okay, my mother made me wear a bun every single day through high school because I had to do ballet every day after school while I walked past the playground and people playing and, you know, guys out there at the basketball court. I didn't have that life. So me making the decisions that I make now have absolutely everything to do with the way that I walked, the way that I lived as a young person, and the way that I plan to raise my son. And so wishful illusions are not something that I choose to live in, but there are some other things that I do choose to live in. So mostly I deal, okay? And the way that I deal is I try to stay in the present, okay? So I need to remove this just a little bit. So, you know, let's just say, for example, you're on a date and you're dating, and I'm dating. And, you know, a lot of times as a woman, you know, we might be like, okay, you know, can we get married? I mean, you know, does he have a house? Or does he have, you know, does he have a car? I mean, does he have any kids? But what I've really tried to learn, and not just with dating and not just with being, you know, an individual, is I just try to stay in the present right now. Like right now I'm here at UB Blake Center talking to you guys about reality. I don't know what the next 5 minutes is gonna be. I can't worry about that. But a lot of times we take on that burden of worrying about so much crap, right? And then we're not able to deal. So one of the biggest things that I practice is mindfulness. And so for a second, if everybody can just place their feet on the ground, because you know I'm a dancer, I'm not going to make you guys do anything. Just place their feet on the ground, place your hands on your lap, and close your eyes. And don't even think about nothing. Don't think about, okay, I got to get this proposal out. Is my child, did I drop lunch off at school? Did I pay that bill? Just really feel your hands on your lap. Feel your feet on this ground. Feel your shoulders pressed down. Listen to your breath. Okay? Just feel. Just ground yourself. Being in the present is so important. So when I get all crazy and want to go off on somebody, I just try to close my eyes. You guys can open your eyes now. Because, you know, some of you guys might fall asleep. I've done it. I'm like, that's like my biggest meditation. I'm like, I try to meditate, and I'm like, did I wake up like the next day? I'm sorry. I've been over to somebody's house, Mama Maria Broom. We meditate, and she's like, you must be really tired. Yeah, I am. So anyway, but I try to do that exercise. Now, not when I'm driving, but sometimes, like if I'm on my way to a meeting or if I'm on my way to see somebody that I really don't vibe with that well, sometimes I just say, okay, my hands are on the steering wheel. And I'm looking straight ahead. And so practicing mindfulness is really important. If you have children, I'm sure, you know, it's hard for us sometimes, but you have to do that as well. Because again, it centers you and it brings you back to the present. So reality check 1, 2, 1, 2. So there are a lot of realities that I experience. I'm going to start with some that I experienced today. So the reality is, I was going to wear heels for you all, but I decided to keep my Jordans on thanks to this young man over here. Woo woo! Because I love sneakers. I want to wear sweatpants like every day. It's like more comfortable for me. But I understand I look really young, so sometimes I got to put the heels on. Okay. The reality is, because I am a black woman running an arts organization, which is, you know, unfortunately rare in Baltimore City, funding is scarce for me. It's hard for me to get my mission across. And so the reality is some of my programs suffer. The reality is finances are not always great. The reality is I'm gonna keep doing what I'm doing because I learned how to make lemonade out of lemons from my wonderful family. The reality is Baltimore has got to be a lot more intentional and inclusive about building relationships. It's not just about business all the time, but it's about social gatherings. I'd rather have dinner with you first, or coffee with you, or maybe even lunch, because I really love to eat. That's a reality too. Instead of us just having to meet, having to talk about this, that, and the other, get to know the person. And so these are some of the realities. And I think that Olivia asked you guys to think about some of the reality checks that you all have experienced. However, I do live in a world of fantasy, so keep your reality away from me. So in closing this, one of the things that I when I meet people, they just like, I just don't get how you have this amazing, like this vast vision. Like, you know, a lot of times people are very process oriented. Like they wanna know like, well, Sharayna, you're gonna take kids to Cuba, but how? I mean, Did you get funding this year? No, I didn't get any funding. I did not get 1 cent of funding from the city, from a foundation. I applied, okay? We're taking 15 youth. We're taking 10 from Frederick Douglass High School, which is on the west side. And we're taking 5 from around the city. And also some young adults that now are young adults between the ages of like 20 and 25 to Cuba. So it's about 20 of us going. And, you know, when I say fantasy, sometimes I really have to think that way in a sense of, you know, if someone says, Sharayna, I wouldn't do that if I was you because you ain't got no money. And does that even make any sense? It makes perfect sense. Because I never forget when I was 21 years old, I think I was 21 or 22, my first boyfriend actually passed away from, he was asleep and he had regurgitated. And he was one of the most wonderful people that I've ever encountered. And I was supposed to actually connect with him that summer. And I learned that he passed. And my girlfriends always tease me because I always say, YOLO, you only live once. And if you are my friend personally, if you interact with me at Muse 360, if you hear me talking to my students, like I really do believe that the impossible is possible. So some people think that I'm living in a fantasy world. But until you actually, again, come and step into my world, and learn a little bit more about what I do, you'll realize that we are making some things happen, and I am making some things happen. One of the things spiritually that I exercise is faith. And it's not so much about a particular religion, but it's just about the faith that everything's gonna be all right. Sometimes we look at our reality and we say, oh my gosh, you know, like Olivia was talking about being in a car accident. Well, the great thing is that she survived. Now, she does need to get checked. I'm gonna make sure she does that. That's the reality. But at the end of the day, you know, a lot of times we think our world is crumbling, but the reality is, and this is something that I teach my youth, when we travel to all these different countries, and we've been to countries like, we've been to like the fishing village in Dominican Republic, for example, and we taught a workshop there. None of the students spoke any English. Now imagine if American children, right, had that same experience. I'm like, well, they don't speak no English, right? We're not doing this workshop. But the reality is, how often do these young people have an opportunity to interact with someone outside of their comfort zone? So here you have about 70 Dominican children, okay, from this fishing village, which technically you're not supposed to come outside when it rains. They came outside for us, okay? And we were able to interact with them. Those are the things that really keep us in check. And it gives us reality. It even gave me a reality check. You know, going to London and Paris last year with my students as well, you know, we interacted with other London British youth that also don't know their culture, also have not met their fathers. There was an Ethiopian young lady who would love to come and study in America, but she's never even had Ethiopian food. And she's 18. because that is a very harsh reality that she doesn't want to face. And so the young people came over every night, which was a lot, because I had to cook for them every night. But they came over just seeking a little piece of this reality, seeking a person like myself that actually cares. And so in closing, I have to fantasize. I have to practice faith. I have to practice, you know, mindfulness when I'm interacting with people. Doesn't mean that I'm always going to be smiling. I do smile a lot, but doesn't mean that I'm always happy, but I am trying to choose happiness. I am dealing with the reality that I do have a burden on my shoulders that you may not have. And if people could practice a lot more empathy, then reality would be a lot easier.
5, 6, 7, and 1, 1, 2, 3.
Muse 360 Arts is a nonprofit based here in Baltimore City that develops youth at a high level in the arts artistically, as well as expose them to experiences that really help nurture them and transform their lives and ultimately help them excel in their chosen endeavors. Essentially, we achieve our mission through 3 signature programs. Rainfall Dance Studio is a program that I started because of my background is in ballet, and I started it at the YMCA Druid Hill, and it grew into a preparatory dance program. And it really provides young people with access to classical ballet, which really encourages discipline and exposes them to allied arts.
Working with Ms. Christmas, she instilled confidence within me, and she also taught me the value of dance. I've been to the Peabody Institute, the Dance Theatre of Harlem Summer Intensives, and I'm actually a BFA candidate for Towson State University and Point Park University, and that's really all because of Muse 360.
We also have Dancing Mini Drums. It's a summer international study abroad program, and we started that in 2007, really trying to expose young people to the world, to different cultures, to history, helping them put it all in the context of the arts and also the African diaspora.
They took us on a journey to Paris and London for 2015, where I really enjoyed it. Like, it was so amazing to me, like, just to get out of the country for the first time. And that's what Muse 360 does for young people. They teach us arts, and not only arts, but history as well, because we compare, you know, our history with the arts and use that to be able to push forward.
The last program that supports our mission is Spark of Genius Youth Entrepreneur Project. It was started actually one summer in 2012 by 2 of our Muse 360 young people who decided that they wanted to explore the idea of owning their own business in a creative field. And now the program has shifted to offer free workshops in life skills, you know, such as learning how to eat right, you know, learning how to manage your money, learning how to build a business model. You know, learning how to communicate.
Muse 360 has really shaped who I am today, the confidence in the way I carry myself, just the qualities you need to have as a person. You don't really learn that in school, so just being a part of these programs has taught me just how to be an amazing person. However you describe that, I feel like I have the qualities to go along with that because of Muse 360. So.
We believe in providing young people with the platform that they need to succeed. And when I say high level, what I really mean is that we do not lower our expectations no matter what your background is. It is very important for young people to see themselves in a successful way. It's very important for them to understand that they can reach higher than the stars. And at Muse 360, we believe in providing them with the support system that they need, engaging the parents, working with the young people, and really making ourselves accountable for their success, and not just in the arts, but in life.
So, that's my fantasy world that I live in. I love it. So, you know, I think, you know, I really do appreciate you all listening to me talk, because I've always been a talker. But more importantly, you know, for me, when I look at, you know, I remind myself of these things so that I continue to do the work that I'm doing. But, you know, it's just really important that, you know, when I look at my young people, they are the future of Baltimore. And that's a reality that people don't want to talk about. I'm not so concerned about people moving into Baltimore. I'm concerned about the young people, the thousands of young people not having proper education, not being able to read, not being able to speak, not being able to describe who they are. That's a crime. And see, the way that I grew up in Harlem, I had a very similar background, but growing up, you are reminded of your excellence. You're reminded of your excellence. Baltimore, UB Blake is a reminder of excellence in Baltimore City. Arena Players is a reminder. When you walk down Pennsylvania Avenue, it's hard to remember those things because the city hasn't put money into preserving it. And so what do you do in that situation? That's a reality we deal with, because I don't have millions of dollars to invest. But if you are sitting in these meetings, if you have the power, if you're connected to someone, then you need to make, if you're really serious about living in Baltimore, if you're serious about making a change, then you need to have those conversations and bring people in. And so my reality, my very small revolutionary mind, not mind, but my very small revolutionary act, is working with young people and seeing their lives change through the arts. The arts allow, being creative allows you to experience being human. And that is the one thing that I believe in. I believe in human beings and our ability to move forward and keep pushing. So that's all I have, and I thank you all, and now I'll take questions. I did want to, there was a reality check thing that I wanted to do with you all. I don't know if you guys actually did it, I don't know, but if anybody wanted to ask questions or share, you know, what their reality check is, you know, the reality is blah, blah, blah. It could be anything. It doesn't have to just be today. We'd like to invite you guys to do so. So thank you.